the four temperaments. And this is a topic which, in my opinion, is very important because it gives us the opportunity to understand not only children but even grown-ups. Because everybody, children, grown-ups, old people, everybody has a combination of these four temperaments. What are these temperaments and how do they express themselves? That we will find out today in the course of my talk. Now, first of all, I would like to just write the four temperaments on the board. Four temperaments. When you meet a person for the first time, whether it is a grown-up or a child, you see certain features of that person. First of all, you see the appearance. Is the person tall or short, fat or thin? Does he have long hair or short hair or curly hair? Or all these features, physical features you see of a person. And a lot of these features tell you something about that person. You can get an impression by looking at a person or by looking at a child, approximately how that person is in his or her character also. Now, in the case of the four temperaments, it is like this. All human beings, every single human being on earth has four temperaments. First of all, we will give them the name of a color, and afterwards we will give the actual name of the temperament. People can have red temperament or yellow or blue or green. But actually we have all four temperaments in us, but one or two of these temperaments are a bit more pronounced than the others. So every one of us has four temperaments, but in some cases the red temperament is more pronounced, in another person's case the yellow temperament is pronounced, and so on. Now if we look at children, if we are teaching children as teachers, and if we are having our own children at home, we can also understand our children very well if we understand the whole subject of the four temperaments. So now let us begin with the first temperament, and that is the red temperament. That's very nice that we have a red color here. So I will just write first of all red. And then afterwards, I will write next to it the actual name which is given to the red temperament. Now, what are the characteristics of a child or an adult who has a red temperament? A red temperament person is very much goal-oriented. Most of the time, they know exactly what they want. They know what they want and then they try and get it, but in a very sure way. They are mostly very sure of themselves. Even the way they walk, from the way they walk you get the impression, oh, this person is very sure of himself or herself. And they are also very precise. They are very clear in their expression. If they want something, they say it, and they give a very good expression also to their speech. In fact, in most cases, you can also say that a person with her red temperament is a born leader. A person who has a red temperament has such characteristic that he or she can lead other people. And people accept that also. Even when they are little children, if they go out and play in the playground, the children with the red temperament usually know that they are going to prepare the whole game. So they take up the leadership even in a group of children, and they tell the other children what to do, and they organize everything, and the children follow what they are saying quite naturally. And similarly also, as grown-ups, they have a certain leadership quality and people follow them very easily. It is very natural for them to be good leaders and to show other people the way. Also, when they stand very firmly. Their feet are firmly placed on the ground, and when they speak directly to the people. And it's a very interesting thing, because when they speak to the people actually sit and listen to them. And there is nothing wishy-washy about people who have the red temperament. Welcome, please. They are not at all wishy-washy. They are definite, they are very clear, they are very precise, and they are very goal-oriented. So when you have a child in the classroom who has a red temperament, then you know that the child can be given responsibility. And if you want to get your work done, then you ask the child with the red temperament to do that work for you. And you can be sure that the child will do that work very clearly and precisely. In fact, they are also not given to multitasking. They don't like multitasking. If they are sitting and reading a book, they will try and finish the book before they do something else. And so they always complete one task before they start a second task. So the children who have red temperaments, or even the grown-ups with red temperaments, they always complete one thing before they start something else. They are also people who have they are quite demanding. So if something does not meet their expectations, they can also get quite angry. And they don't like other people to be indisciplined. So they usually tell other people off when they are doing something wrong. And they say, oh, you shouldn't do that, you know, you should do it like this. And they are very clear about giving directions to other people to tell them what is right and what is not right. They also follow the rules very clearly, and they also are very organized and in most cases quite disciplined. So it's good to have a red person in our midst, because they can be quite enlightening as far as the matter of having special rules and regulations is concerned. In fact, I think if we had more people with the red temperament in society, we would have a more regulated society, because our red temperament people, they do not like the attitude of sab chalta hai. No, they don't like sab chalta hai. It should not be sab chalta hai. Everything should be very precise, and we should maintain a high level of standards. We should have high standards, and we should try and keep those standards. Now, what is the actual name for the red temperament? The people who have a red temperament are called choleric people. Children, grown-ups who have a red temperament, they are called choleric. You can also expect them to lose their temper, but they lose their temper for a particular reason. Not just like that out of the blue, but if they are prodded and if there is a reason, then they actually lose the temper and they can be quite angry. So people also are well behaved in their presence. If a teacher is choleric, then the children are mostly very well behaved, because they do not want the teacher to get angry with them. So in short, we have here the red person. Also, when they walk, they have a very special way of walking. They dig their heels in the earth when they walk, and when they are standing and talking, they have very strong gestures, and they point to this and they point to that. You can also see in some of our netas or our politicians, you can recognize the red temperament in some of our politicians when they are standing there and telling the janta what to do and what not to do. So let us now leave the red temperament and move over to the next one. The next temperament I would like to speak to you about is the green temperament. And very nicely, we also have a green pen here. So first I will write green, and after that I will write the actual name of that green temperament. What is the characteristic of a child or a grown-up who has a green temperament? The people who have a green temperament are very, very laid back. Nothing disturbs them. They don't get easily agitated. They don't get easily perturbed. They take life very easily. If something terrible happens, you will not see the people with the green temperament getting out of themselves. They will just look around and try to see what is going on. They will try to judge the situation, but they will not get agitated, and they will also not get involved. They will just be passive spectators, because people who have a green temperament are also very passive by nature. They are very passive and they are very laid back, and they just like to have a comfortable life. They don't want to get involved in all kinds of agitations. They prefer to just sit and watch what is happening. Now, if you see the playground, the school bell has just rung and all the children are coming out into the playground to play. The children who have a green temperament usually don't like to play, because that would be too agitating. All kinds of games and who wins and who loses and all that competition. The green children would like to sit by the side of the playground and watch the other children playing and getting all hot and bothered and sweaty, and they just sit and watch and are quite happy with themselves. They are also fond of the good things of life. So one of the things that they really like is some good food. And when they are sitting in the classroom and they are daydreaming, and the teacher says, "All right, you dear child, what did I just say?" And the child has not been paying attention. So the child says, "Oh, ma'am, I don't know what you said." And then the teacher said, "What were you thinking of?" And if the child were honest, the child would say, "I'm thinking of the next bread and butter sandwich for my next break." So they are very easygoing, and they also don't get angry easily. Even if other children mock at them and tease them and all, they don't mind. They just say, "Oh, go. Stop it, I'm not interested." And it's very good to have such children in the class, because they are very stable. They have a stabilizing effect on the other children. And it's nice to put them in the middle of the class, because they are very stable. And for example, if there is a bell, you know, we have these fire drills, and the bell is ringing in the fire drill, and all the other children get up and start moving towards the door, the green child will also get up, but it will get up very slowly and walk slowly towards the door without getting excited. Ah, now we have tea. I hope we have enough tea break. This is very good for the green people in our yes. Away. Ah, oh, I'm glad you told me that. Thank you so much. Oh yes, that is probably the case. Oh, aapne chai piya? You had, no? But ek chai kam hai, bhaiya? Ye ek aur chai lana, please. Suniye, ek aur chai lana, ha? Aur fir hamare paas paisa.
Same for the boys and the girls?
Yes, it is the same for the boys and the girls. And no, it is not always like that. You see, in many cases it is like that. In many cases, the child of a red person will also have a little bit of that red in him. But boys and girls both have the same temperament. In fact, we have four temperaments, and all four temperaments are in us. We all have red and green and yellow and blue. The only thing is that one or two are stronger than the others. They are more in the foreground, you know. So a person who is red might have a little bit of green, but mostly the temperament is red. That is the most prominent of the four. So that is why. And it has nothing to do with being a boy or a girl or being old or young. One thing I must tell you at this point is that when a child has a certain temperament, the temperament changes over the years. And then when the child grows up and becomes an adult, then the child's adult temperament is different from his childhood temperament. So this is something that you will always observe. You always notice that in any person, the temperament that he or she had as a child is a completely different temperament than when they become adults. So this is important to note. Old age, then it becomes a little more mellowed. Then the person becomes more balanced. For example, let's say a person is very red as a young man or a young woman, maybe in his 20s or 30s. But as they get older and older, that redness becomes a little bit less, and it becomes more balanced. So old people have, in fact, you can say, a balanced temperament. All four temperaments are more or less in balance. Now, another thing about the green temperament is that the children, especially the children who have a green temperament, you have to always take them with you, because they get lost in their daydreams and they tend to think about other things while the work is going on or while the class is going on. So you have to make sure, if you are a teacher, you have to make sure that you always ask the child a sudden question, you know, and wake him out of his dreams. Because these children are very fond of daydreaming. And as I said, they are also very fond of comfort. And sometimes you can even say they are a bit thick-skinned. If the teacher scolds a green child, the child will not get very upset. He'll say, okay, teacher scolded me, so what? Usme kya hua? She will forget. And then they are the same. So you cannot really get very annoyed with a green child, because it has very little effect. So they are quite thick-skinned. Now, what is the green temperament actually called? The green temperament is called phlegmatic. It is the phlegmatic temperament. So that is your green child. And just as a red child walks with the heels digging in the ground very strongly, a green child usually walks slowly and placing the feet a bit flat on the ground. You know, they sort of plod along. And they are very much at peace with themselves and with the world around them. Not agitated, not excitable, but quite slow and steady. Especially they are very steady. Now let us go over to the yellow temperament. But we don't have a yellow pen, so I'll use the black pen, but I will write the word yellow. Now, what is the yellow temperament? What kind of children or grown-ups have a yellow temperament? So this is something we can find out. A yellow temperament person is someone who is very much into multitasking. They will do this, a little bit of this, and a little bit of that, and a little bit of that. And their concentration is very short. They have a very short attention span. Even in the classroom, when the teacher is saying something, they are all the time, you know, thinking of this and that. And it is, they are very flighty. You know, once they are interested in one thing, then the flickering mind, you can say definitely. And also, they do many things, one after the other. For example, if they sit down to read a book, I have said the red child sits down, reads the book from cover to cover, and only then will it do something else. But a yellow child, it will take a book, read a few pages, then put the book away and go and play outside. Then after a while it comes in. They are always doing many, many things, and each thing they only do it for a short time. Short time, short time, short time. Incomplete. They usually do not complete. Unlike the red child, the yellow children usually do not complete what they are doing. And the teacher is always running after them saying, complete this, do that, you know. And they are very sort of light in their whole behavior, you know. They are also very light-hearted.
They are jumping jack.
Pardon?
Jumping jack.
Jumping jack, like that.
More talkative.
They also can be very talkative. Yes, yes. They are talkative. They also disturb other children. For example, they finish their work quickly, you know, very rough, you know. Even the writing is very light and rough, and they just finish something. They don't take good care of what they are doing. And then they start disturbing the other children. They say, hey, where did you get your pencil from? That's a nice pencil. And so they'll start talking to this one and that one, and they start disturbing the other children. And if you tell a little girl, tell me, my dear, who is your best friend? And normally one says only one name, no? Best friend. But this girl will say, oh, I have many best friends. I have Sita and Gita and Rita and Amita, and, you know, she will name many, many other children. So she is, or he is, it can be a boy or a girl, a yellow child will have many, many interests. And they are very interested in many things, but they never go deep into anything. They always remain on the surface. They are like a butterfly. Have you seen a butterfly?
Yeah.
It flies here and then suddenly it changes the direction and flies there. Once on this flower, once on that flower. You never know what direction the butterfly will take. They are always changing the direction, changing their flowers, changing their interests. And it is a little bit like that also with the yellow children. They are all the time changing their field of interest. Even when they dress up, now for example, a little girl, if you ask the little girl what she would like to wear for a party, then she will wear bows and clips and lots of things in her hair and frills and that kind of a thing, you know, everything very feathery and very frothy. And these children are also very fond of good things of life, but in a very superficial way. They have a tendency to be a bit superficial. And if you get angry on a yellow child, that child will take no notice. And then you say, now listen, this should not happen again. Did you understand? And they will say, yes, yes. But the next minute, they just go and do something else. Yes, they are very light and flighty. And for a, pardon me? Yes, but you see, a yellow child is difficult to have in the class, because you always have to tell the child, sit down, yes, and it is easily distracted. A yellow child is also easily distracted. So we always have to say, calm down, sit down, don't be like that, wait a minute. Yes, we still have 10 minutes before the classes. No, you see, with hyperactive, it is actually a problem of the child itself. Even a choleric child or even a phlegmatic child can be hyperactive because of certain mistakes that the parents make, perhaps in the diet or something. But that is a characteristic. But this is a temperament which is continuously the same. Now, if a child is hyperactive, you can do certain things with the child to make him calm down. But with her yellow child, this tendency of being distracted all, that remains quite static. Yes. Yes. This is it. You can say that. Yes. So the yellow temperament is also called the sanguine temperament. So that brings us to the last. You can also think about your own self. What is my temperament? What is the temperament of my wife or my husband or my child or my auntie or uncle? Think of all the people who are close to you and try to see what is his temperament, what is her temperament, what is the temperament of certain politicians whom we see on television or in a... Yeah, for example, changing the party, very sanguine, no? One day this, one day that. But there are some people who remain true to what they are doing, very stable. Well, I'm not going to make any comments on that. But there are some very good politicians who are very red, very choleric. And they know exactly what they want. And people follow them and are very happy to follow them. Pardon me? Yeah, you can say she was quite choleric also, yes, definitely. So people did listen to what she had to say and did follow her. And she was very precise in what she wanted, goal-oriented. Now we come to the last temperament, and that is the blue temperament. And now let us see how a blue temperament works. Children, especially children, but even grown-ups who have a blue temperament, these children are extremely sensitive. They are very, very sensitive, and you have to be very careful how you approach them. Because if you scold them, they feel very insulted, and they feel really bad, and they can't come out of it, and they feel very hurt.
They take lightly anything.
No, they don't take it lightly. No, lightly, yellow temperament. Blue temperament, they don't take anything lightly. On the contrary, they take it to heart. They take it too much to heart. Let's say you are having a few blue children in the class, and you have a class of about 30-40 children, and you are telling all the children together something. So you might be perhaps reproaching them and saying, yesterday you behaved very badly in the needlework teacher's class. Why did you all behave like that? Now these blue children, they think that the teacher is scolding only them. The other children, they don't mind, but the blue children, they feel very, very hurt. No, you would not say that they are egoistic. That way they are not, but they are oversensitive. They are oversensitive, and they just feel very isolated also. Sometimes they even ask themselves, am I really my own parents' child, or was I changed in the hospital with some other baby? Sometimes, you know, they have many doubts like that, self-doubts and so on. But especially they are really oversensitive. And you have to be very careful how you approach a blue child. If you get annoyed with a green child, that child is very thick-skinned. It will not mind. But if you get annoyed with a blue child, that child will really feel very bad.
They remember for whole life.
Yes. They don't forget. Even when they are grown up and they remember their school days, they will remember that teacher who scolded them on that particular day. They are like that. They are oversensitive. And also with their friends, they usually have one good friend with whom they share all their sad stories. And they think they are having a very, very difficult life. In fact, they are not, but they think like that. They imagine that their life is very sad. They imagine that, and they always think that life is treating them very badly, when in fact it might not be the case. But they always feel like that. They feel singled out. And so you have to always think, now with the sad child, you also have to show that child that she or he is not the only one who is sad. You have to show, see, there are many people in this world who are sad, and actually God has given you a good life, so you should be happy with what you have been given. And these children, they also tend to be low loners. They prefer to keep to themselves and just like to do things on their own, or as I said, with one very special friend with whom they can share all their life's sorrows.
Ideal.
Also, yes, you can say that they do have a tendency to put everything in its place. Everything. They have a very, very good attention for details. Very good attention for details. Yes, they prefer to be punctual. They might even come a bit earlier than the others because they don't want to upset others. Just as they don't want to be upset by others, they also don't want to upset other people. So they do have attention for details, and they try to follow the rules and regulations very properly. Also because they don't want to be scolded or singled out for something that they may have done wrong. And the person who has a blue temperament, that is a melancholic person. Melancholic person. You can also say that these four temperaments are related to four elements. Now, the blue temperament, the temperament of a melancholic person, it is like the earth, very hard, very immovable. Just as the earth is hard and immovable. Of course, if you add water, that's different. But earth by itself is hard and stiff, and you cannot really do much with it. It is very stiff and hard, and it cannot be molded unless you add water to it. So the people who have a melancholic temperament, you can say that the temperament is a little bit like the element earth. Now let us go to the yellow temperament. That is more like the air element, because air is always moving. Sometimes it's going up, sometimes down, sometimes right, left. Sometimes it goes into a cyclone, sometimes it goes very still. It's always moving, so you can never predict air. It is also the sanguine people also are quite unpredictable. What will they do next? We cannot tell. So now the green temperament is like water. Yes, if you take water by itself, it remains in one place.
Just in any situation.
Exactly. Water is very adjustable. It will adjust in any situation. If you put water in a round container, it will take a round shape. And if you put water in a long container, it will put a long shape. And water has no movement. Yes. Exactly. But you can also say water has no movement of its own. Water can never move on its own. It has to be made to move. If there is a waterfall, it is because the water is going from up to down. But water by itself has no movement.
The wind is there, the water.
Yes. If the wind is there, then the wind can make waves. For example, now in the monsoon, if you go to the sea, the waves are very high. Why? Because the winds are very strong, and that is why the water is made to move. But water by itself can be related to the green or the phlegmatic temperament. So this is something that is quite important to know. And now we come to the red choleric. What? Yes, very much. They are very fiery. You know, sometimes you talk about people and you say, "Arey, this person is very fiery." You know, they can really hot-tempered, also martial. Exactly, they have a very strong Mars planet in them, and they can also ignite the interest of others. Sometimes they can speak in such a way that they can inspire a whole group of people. I don't know if you ever had a chance to see the Chief Minister of Gujarat, Narendra Modi. When he speaks ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. His speech is very, very good. Especially when he speaks Gujarati, his speech is excellent. And he does not stop speaking. You know, he speaks like the flowing water. And then he uses his arms and he does this and he does that. And he speaks in such a way that the people who are listening to him, they are fascinated. They are very much impressed. And they can also be very much influenced by him. Because he also also has a whole lot of ideas and he can express himself very well. And all the people who are listening to him, they say, wow, how well he speaks. But for example, if you see green, now there was our Prime Minister, do you remember our Prime Minister Vajpayee? Atal Bihari Vajpayee, he was a little bit this green temperament. He was very calm, very quiet, always smiling, always adjusting. Even when he gave a speech, he spoke slowly, he spoke very precisely, but he spoke slowly. He kept his cool. He never got agitated, he never got excited. He was very calm, very stable. So like that, you can make observations of your own and see what kind of a temperament does this person have, what kind of a temperament does that person have. But don't forget, my dear friends, we have all the four in us. All the four. There is no person who does not have one temperament. We have all the four, but in some people the green is more prominent, and in another person maybe the blue is more prominent. There are also entire folks which have temperaments. Now, for example, by and large, generally speaking, you can say that the people who are Indians, we have more or less this yellow temperament. Yellow and a bit of green, a mixture of these two. We are also very adjustable, very calm, very adjustable, and we are also very distracted. You know, multitasking. If you go to a shop, and then the person is asking you, yes, what do you want? Then you say this. Then suddenly he'll start to speak on the mobile. Then he'll attend to some other customer like that, you know. It's all a little bit of everything. And then you say, "Arey, listen, I've been waiting now, please hurry up," and like that. So we have to see how is it also with entire folks. There is also something called the folk temperament. So like that, we can have a very good insight. And if we know that the child's temperament is a particular one, then we can help them by bringing out the others. For example, if a child is very blue, very, very blue, and always sad and always retiring and isolated and all, then you try to bring out a little bit of his or her other temperaments through telling stories, through the right diet. Sometimes it also happens that the child... I would not say that it happens suddenly, but sometimes it can also happen that the child has a certain likeness. Now, for example, there are some children who like to eat too much sweet, and they are all the time eating sweets and sweets. Now, we know that if there is too much sweet in our blood level, then what happens is that the children become very overactive, you know. Also, they can't get to sleep. If they eat too much sweet, then they also become overactive. So we have to see that we try and cut down on their sugar intake and give them other substitutes. Because, for example, instead of giving them sugar, you can give them dates or figs or some such things, you know, which also have sweetness, but not the same kind of sweetness as white sugar, which, as we all know, is quite yes, exactly, they have a lot of that. So on the whole, you can try and recognize the temperament of the people in your surroundings, and also of your children, maybe your grandchildren, your neighbors' children. Try to make these observations and see how you can help them in other ways. Yes? Ah, he brought a thermos. Abhi to do log.
Do chai.
Unko. Very good. Nahi, humne to piya. I had, yes. I had, before you came, I already had. Thank you so much. Would somebody like a second cup?
No.
No? Please, he has got many cups.
You made it very well.
Very nice. नहीं नहीं, if you want, he has. आपके पास और भी चाय है? बहुत है. अगर किसी को दूसरा कप चाहिए तो उनको देना, हाँ? Would you like? Yes, please. Who else would like? Please tell him. Would you like? No? Okay. Very good. Anybody else? Please take it. It's a very good tea. Okay. Oh. I think you'll need a second cup. Okay. Achha toh, I'll just pay him before he goes. This study of the four temperaments was introduced by Dr. Rudolf Steiner. If you remember, some of you came to my last talk, and in my last talk I had spoken about Rudolf Steiner's methodology in world of education, if you remember. Pardon me? Oh yes, sorry. Is this better? Okay. Yes, that is true. So, if you remember, in my last talk, I had spoken to you like this. I had spoken to you about Dr. Rudolf Steiner and Waldorf education. Now, Dr. Rudolf Steiner, he was born in 1861, like Rabindranath Tagore. They were both born in 1861. And Rudolf Steiner died in 1925. So actually he was very young when he passed away. He was only 64 when he passed away. But during these 64 years, he did a lot of work on earth. And a lot of research. He did research in child education, in medicine, in agriculture, and so on and so forth. And Rudolf Steiner brought up something that used to be known among the Greek people long, long ago. Many centuries ago, the people of Greece, you know, they were very advanced philosophically, culturally. The people of Greece were very advanced. They were great philosophers. And in fact, Greece, you can say, is the cradle of European civilization. Just as India is the cradle of Asian civilization. If you look at Asia today, you see Buddhism, you see Hinduism, all these religions have traveled to different parts of Asia, Southeast Asia, Far East Asia, and many of the countries in Asia have been very much influenced by India. India has influenced the culture and the art and the religious and philosophical life of Asia to a great extent. Similarly, Greece has had the same effect and influence on Europe. So you can say that Greece is the cradle of European civilization and India is the cradle of Asian civilization. Now in ancient Greece, the people had a very good understanding of human nature, of philosophy, of art, of different aspects of life. And they were very wise and they put all this wisdom into their everyday life. And one of the things that they recognized was the four temperaments. In fact, these four words are of Greek origin. But then slowly, slowly, this whole idea of the four temperaments disappeared. And even in Greece, you know, things started changing very much. And today, the present day Greece is nowhere near what ancient Greece used to be. But Rudolf Steiner revived this study of the four temperaments. He said that what the ancient Greek people understood, that was something very important. And if we want to recognize a human characteristic, if we want to know why a certain person or a grown-up or a certain child is behaving in a certain way, we have to understand that person's temperament. And if we can really understand the temperament, then we can help that person. Now, for example, if there is too much of the temperament in the person, then some problems can arise. For example, if there is too much red, then the person can get into a rage. And sometimes they can get very much into a rage and they can do things that they would, they can even harm other people. So one has to see that it never comes to that. Yes, they can even become dictators, exactly. Hitler, for example, very good example. That is also very important. Yes. In fact, this is... It is true. Yes. Yes, exactly. You know, that is also something. Now, for example, this is a very good example, you know. If a person is very, very, very blue, very melancholic, then they will feel so bad about everything and, you know, they will feel everybody is... Exactly, there is a very strong tendency to be depressed and sometimes, exactly, it can become suicidal because too much of a depressive nature, yes, then the person can just put an end to their life because they are so depressed and they take everything so much to heart that they say, life is not worth living, and then they kill themselves. So before it comes to that, people who are around them should see the signs. You know, when such things happen, we have to say, where were the people who are close to them? Because if the people who are close to them would really observe them, then they will see the signs, you know. Then they will see, oh, this person is slowly becoming depressed, or this person is slowly getting into a rage. You know, for example, there are some people who out of a great, strong rage, they do something, you know, without thinking, and afterwards then see what they have done, and then they are so, they're full of remorse, but then it's too late. You can't turn the clock backwards. It's done, it's finished. So if a person is red and gets into a rage, or a person is too blue and gets into a very depressive mood, or for example, a green child, if a person is too green, they can also become a little bit dull-minded, you know. They can become a bit dull in their mind. Yeah, well, you can say that they are becoming a little bit dim-witted, yes. And if a child is too yellow, too sanguine, too much like that, then they become also a little bit hysterical. So we have to really observe the people around us, and if somebody is showing a sign of going overboard, then we have to say, wait, we have to watch out. We have to help the people. It is our duty to help the people around us. And some people don't take help. You know how it is. Some people say, oh, I don't need your help. You can keep your help to yourself. I'm fine. And sometimes people think they are fine, when in fact they are not. So we can say, look, I'm your friend. I want the best for you.
But they won't understand that easily.
You have to try and speak to them nicely. You have to be very gentle and very, you have to be very tactful. You have to speak very, very nicely to them and say, look, can I say something? You are very close to me. You are my friend or you are my brother or whatever. But I would like to say something to you. You can listen to me. If you don't think it's good, forget it. But at least take some time to listen. And then have a quiet conversation over a cup of tea or something, you know. And just say, look, I have noticed that lately you have become very, very angry for small, small reasons. You are becoming angry. What is the problem? Why don't you calm down a little bit? And like that, you can help. Or somebody who is very depressed and say, I've observed that lately you are withdrawing into your shell. You are not spending time with other people. You are spending too much time alone. You seem to be depressed. What is the problem? Maybe I can help you. Maybe you can go on a holiday or something. You know, you can always try and help the people, and this is very important. I can assure you that if people can speak their heart out, they would think twice before taking their life. You know, there are also these suicide lines, helplines, And there was a very interesting article recently in the newspaper in Times of India that many people have been saved by the helpline. They give an example of one person. He was suicidal and he really wanted to commit suicide. But then he thought, before I commit suicide, chalo, let's try the helpline. And he rang up the helpline. And they don't say who was on the other end of the line. But this man spoke for 3 hours to that person whom he does not know at the other end. And after that, that person must have been like an angel. That person spoke so nice, changed the life. That man said, no, I'm not going to commit suicide. And he decided there and then that suicide was not the answer. So you see that too much of any one temperament can be abnormal. And if it takes an abnormal shade, then we, who are their friends, their close relatives, their confidants, we have to see that we try and help them by being with them, spending some time with them. Sometimes people just want someone to be with them. Maybe not even talk, but no, that person is there. Moral support, very important. Moral support is very important. So this is how we can understand the study of the four temperaments. Now, of course, one can say many, many things about the four temperaments. But I would like to end this talk by giving you a little story. Not a story, but like, a little, what shall I say? A little anecdote. But it hasn't actually happened. It can happen. There is a street in some town, and the street is quite narrow. Now somehow a big rock has rolled into the street and has settled in the middle of the street.
Blocked the road,
exactly. Now the road is blocked, and now one by one, four people come into the street, one by one. First comes the red person, the choleric person. Now what do you think
he will do?
Tell.
Hell is who did this.
Yeah. He will shout. Who was the person who did it?
Yes.
Yes. Now exactly, as you rightly said, the first question will be, who brought this here? What is this nonsense? He will start raving and ranting. And then at the same time, he will not wait for anybody to come.
He will not climb.
Climb, somebody else will climb. We will look at that. He will try to push that rock. And he will not rest until he has removed that rock from the street. And then he will move it aside, and then he will walk, and he will make the road free for others also. So this is a person who has action, a man of action, a woman of action. They have cleared the road, and now he says, right, and I hope this doesn't happen again. And he will bang his foot on the ground for good measure and walk ahead. Okay. Green, what will the green person do when he comes to that rock?
He will divert his mind.
Yes? Okay. Somebody said he will go back. No, I don't think he will go back. But he will go either around, yes. And if there is no place to go around, what will he do?
Go on the
boat. No, he's green. Yes, you already said divert, but what else can he do?
He will try to climb.
No, you know what he will do? If he can, he will sit on the rock and he will unpack his bag and take out a sandwich and start eating. Aram se. He says, if the rock is in the middle, let me make the best of it. And he will make the best of a difficult situation. So he will either try to go around that rock, and if that fails, he will sit on the rock and
if
he will just
up, then he will.
Yes. And then afterwards he will carry on. Okay. What will the yellow person do?
Try to climb on it.
Yes. Try to climb on it or even jump over it, because they are very light and always sort of like jumping up. Yes. Like butterflies. So that person will try to jump over it, but they will not mind it. They will not be angry like the red person, but they will say, oh, okay, rock in the middle. Okay. So what? I can jump. It's no problem. Huh. And what will the blue person do? He will either he will go back or he will say like this, it happens to me. Aaj ka din bhi kharab ho gaya. And he'll say, aise toh mujhe hi hota hai. Nobody else. It always happens only to me. And he will sit near the rock with his head in the hand and become very woeful. So dear friends, like that, you can illustrate the four temperaments to other people by giving little anecdotes like that, you know. So this is what I would like to share with you today. Part of life. It's very much a part of life, dear friends. And I'm very glad you all came today.
Very good.
Thank you very much.